Hello, this is Brandon Kennedy from Wayne State University School of Medicine, and today we will be discussing a few common optic neuropathies. The appearance of the optic nerve can oftentimes clue into many problems happening within the eye or the brain. The picture on the far left is the appearance of a normal optic nerve with sharp, well-defined borders. However, the photo in the middle and the photo on the right show appearances of two swollen nerves where the borders are no longer sharp. The central photo also has two disc hemorrhages, superior and inferior, and the photo on the right shows blood vessel obscurations. The first optic neuropathy we will be discussing is optic neuritis, which is inflammation of the optic nerve. Understand the common presenting signs and symptoms, which include decreased vision, periorbital pain worsened with eye movement, optic nerve dysfunction. Risk factors include being female, and the peak incidence happens between 20 to 45 years old, and often with a prodromal flu-like illness. Also be aware of prior history of multiple sclerosis. Exam findings may include an APD, visual field defects, or optic disc edema. The differential diagnosis for optic neuritis includes ischemic optic neuropathy, acute papilledema, severe systemic hypertension, or an orbital or intracranial tumor. Optic neuritis is a clinical diagnosis. However, it is important to note that MRI is oftentimes necessary for stratifying the risk of multiple sclerosis. For treatment, consider IV steroids. The landmark study, Optic Neuritis Treatment Trial, did note that IV steroid treatment increased rapidity of return of vision, however, it did not improve final visual outcome. It also found that never to use PO steroids because this increases the risk of multiple sclerosis developing. Giant cell arteritis, or commonly referred to as GCA, is an optic neuropathy caused by granulomatous inflammation of blood vessels, leading to their destruction and ischemia of the target tissues. This is also called anterior arteritic ischemic optic neuropathy, or AAION. Common ocular signs and symptoms include unilateral vision loss, episodes of amaurosis fugax, an APD, a chalk white appearance of the optic nerve with edema, and possible disc hemorrhages and cotton wool spots. It is important to note that common systemic signs are also present. These signs and symptoms include new onset headache, scalp tenderness, jaw claudication, weight loss, fevers, fatigue and chills, and tender prominent temporal artery with weak or absent pulses. GCA is a clinical diagnosis. However, certain inflammatory lab markers such as ESR or CRP can raise your suspicion of having GCA. However, be cautious because these do have a low sensitivity and can be confounded by other comorbidities. The gold standard for diagnosis is a temporal artery biopsy, which can be performed up to 2 weeks after initiation of corticosteroids. Treatment is immediate high-dose corticosteroids to prevent vision loss in the other eye, and this must be started immediately. Non-arteritic ischemic optic neuropathy, or NAION, is an optic neuropathy caused from an circulatory insufficiency of the optic nerve head. Common signs and symptoms include a hemifield visual field defect, vision loss, decreased color vision, or an APD. Refer to the image above and you can also see a unilateral sectoral optic nerve edema, and with the image below you can see that the disc is crowded and this is in the unaffected eye. NAION is a clinical diagnosis of exclusion. Therefore, it is important to consider NAION versus AAION. This is done based off of presentation and clinical appearance, as well as optic disc neuritis and mass lesions. There is no proven therapy for NAION, but we recommend optimizing the patient's cardiovascular risk factors. There is a 15 to 24% chance of involvement of the contralateral eye after 5 years. The next optic neuropathy we will be discussing is papilledema. Papilledema is defined by bilateral optic disc swelling secondary to an increase in intracranial pressure. There are many etiologies when considering papilledema. These include, but are not limited to, idiopathic intracranial hypertension, intracranial tumors, hydrocephalus, intracranial hematomas or hemorrhages, venous sinus thrombosis, and meningitis. It is important to evaluate with MRI, MRV, and LP for opening pressures to rule out any mass lesions, hemorrhages, or venous sinus thrombosis. Note that imaging must be performed prior to LP. Papilledema may also be caused by medications. Some of the more common ones include tetracyclines, vitamin A derivatives, OCPs, sulfa antibiotics, and steroids. Visual field disturbances are common, however, may not be picked up on physical exam. Most commonly, papilledema will lead to an enlarged blind spot. Treatment is tailored towards the etiology. Acute angle-closure glaucoma may lead to an optic neuropathy. It is also a very important cause of acute vision loss, commonly due to pupillary block, resulting in the failure of aqueous humor to flow from the posterior to the anterior chamber. This is most prevalent in Asians, those with hyperopia, shallow anterior chambers, family history, or short axial length. Common presenting symptoms include intense ocular pain, halos around lights, transient vision loss, blurred vision, frontal headache, nausea, and vomiting. Clinical diagnosis can be aided by gonioscopy, indentation gonioscopy, and UVM. Management of acute angle-closure glaucoma may vary due to physician preference. However, it is important to rapidly initiate intraocular pressure-lowering medications. These come in the form of drops, such as prostaglandins, alpha-2 agonists, beta-blockers, carbamic anhydrase inhibitor, or hyperosmolar agents. Consider the contraindications in each drug class. Also, surgical management is an option, commonly in the form of LPIs, laser peripheral iridotomy. You can see in the upper right-hand picture an LPI at about 1 o'clock. Also, consider filtration surgeries and cataract extraction if need be. Certain medications can actually precipitate acute angle closure. Oftentimes, these medications work on the autonomic nervous system, causing pupillary dilation and thereby inducing pupillary block in susceptible patients. These predisposed patients are often those with hyperopia, narrowed angles such as the Asian population, shallow anterior chambers, or short axial length. There is a list below of the common medications, however, there are many more not listed on this slide. Angle-closure glaucoma may also be due to a secondary cause, such as neovascular glaucoma, where you have compromised aqueous outflow at the trabecular meshwork due to neovascularization, proliferation, and contraction of fibrovascular tissue at the angle. Another secondary cause of angle-closure glaucoma is uveitic glaucoma. The resulting inflammation from uveitis in the anterior chamber may cause a 360-degree posterior sneaky eye, which blocks the aqueous outflow, resulting in anterior bowing of the iris. You can see this in the images to the right. Thank you for tuning into our presentation. On this last slide, we have compiled some high-yield step-related associations for optic neuritis, giant cell arteritis, and papilledema. We hope these help. Thank you again.